A Philippine lawmaker calls on his colleagues to reallocate some confidential funds to agencies that provide basic services. Albay Representative Edsel Lagman says, while it's good to boost funding for agencies protecting the country's maritime territory, the government should not neglect its other welfare projects, such as in health and education.
Ako ay hindi tumututol sa pag-reallocate dun sa mga agencies na nagbibigay ng nag-protect ng Philippine interest sa West Philippine Sea. Pero huwag masyadong marami sapagkat yung funds should be reallocated to basic agencies like education, itong labor, itong agriculture, other services like health, kailangan yan. For example, sa education, kailangan ka mag-reallocate ng funds upang meron tayong pundo para sa school site acquisition. Sa Department of Health, dagdagan natin yung medical assistance program.
Lagman's remark comes after House leaders decided to realign civilian agencies' secret funds to those tasked to ensure national security. But Lagman believes pouring more budget is not enough to counter China's aggression.
No amount of confidential funds can tame a bully. No amount of confidential funds can resolve the issue of a Chinese existence and occupancy of Philippine territories, the West Philippine Sea, as awarded by the arbitrary tribunal. Kailangan meron tayong other peaceful means. At ako ay nagsasuggest na we should have or implement a calibrated economic sanction against China.
On to the West Philippine Sea front, President Marcos taking a stand against Beijing's aggression. The president vowed the Philippines would keep defending its territory. Now this after the Philippine Coast Guard removed China-installed barriers in Scarborough Shoal. Marcos, however, clarifies the country is not seeking to stir up trouble with China.
At hindi naman pare, nalalagyan ng barrier na ganun. At maliwanag naman ay nasa loob ng Pilipinas yan. Hindi tayo naghahanap ng gulo. Basta gagawin natin, patuloy natin, ipapagtanggol ang Pilipinas, ang maritime territory ng Pilipinas, ang karapatan ng mga fisherman natin na mag-isda doon sa mga areas kung saan sila nangingisda. Basta kagaya na sa ko, hindi umiiwas nga tayo sa gulo, umiiwas tayo sa mga maiinit na salita. Ngunit matibay ang ating pagdepensa sa teritoryo ng Pilipinas.
The Philippine Coast Guard confirms Chinese vessels continue to swarm the area. Despite this, authorities are not keen to accept help from Filipino fishermen who offered to document China's actions in the Philippine waters.
We would really appreciate that kind of, patriotic voluntarism. But as far as the national government is concerned, we also don't want to, jeopardize their safety. So I think the national government wouldn't do that, no? Kung kakayanin naman ng mga tao pa rin natin, tayo mismo mag-document yan at hindi natin idadamay ang mga inosenteng mga isda.
The municipality of Masinloc, Zambales is preparing a Philippine flag with its banner to be raised at the Scarborough Shoal, but with one condition. Jackie Manabat is now on the line with that story. Hi, Jackie. What can you tell us?
Nikki, the Masinloc municipality is bent on asserting its territorial rights at the Bajo de Masinloc or the Scarborough Shoal. For this, they prepared a Philippine flag with the municipality's banner ready to be raised at the Scarborough Shoal with one condition. The Philippine Coast Guard must first drive away the Chinese vessels of the area. Bajo de Masinloc is an integral part of the Philippine territory and part of the municipality of Masinloc, province of Zambales. It is located 124 nautical miles west of Zambales and is within the 200 nautical mile exclusive zone, or EEZ, and the Philippine Continental Shelf. municipality bear plans of returning to the southeast entrance of the reef anytime soon with the Philippine Coast Guard and the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources. But local officials want the Philippine Coast Guard to first drive away the Chinese vessels before they raise their flag at the reef. The municipality says the welfare of their fishermen is their priority, and they do not want them to be caught in the escalating tension in the disputed reef.
Kasi nag-o-offer po ang Coast Guard na i-guide ang mga fisher folks doon sa lugar. Kahapon nag-meeting kami ng Sangguniang Bayan, nandito kahapon. Nasabi ko, sumama yung dalawang kagawad at samahan yung ating mangingisda na ilagay yung kwan. Sabi ko, dalhin yung flag para i-assert natin na yan ay sakop ng Masinloc, bayan ng Masinloc, at sakop ng bansang Pilipinas.
Nikki, for now, the fishermen have been advised to refrain from entering the traditional fishing ground. Based on the 2016 arbitral ruling that favored the Philippines, the Scarborough Shoal is a traditional fishing ground, which means that Filipinos, Vietnamese, and even the Chinese can fish within the 12 nautical mile sea of the reef. That's the latest from Zambales. Back to you, Nikki.
All right, thanks as always, Jackie. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. orders the release of 12.7 billion pesos for the Rice Farmers Financial Assistance Program. The program is meant to help rice farmers sustain their productivity amid challenges faced by the agriculture sector. Under the RFFA, about 2.3 million small rice farmers will receive 5,000 pesos each in financial assistance. Those eligible are farmers tilling below 2 hectares of land. Now, Marcos also extended the 15,000 peso financial assistance to small rice retailers affected by the implementation of the rice price cap. The Philippine Central Bank expecting inflation to further go up this September. The Banco Central sees the consumer price index at a range of 5.3 to 6.1% on the back of higher fuel and energy prices and key agricultural commodities. The BSP also pointing to the weaker peso as among factors of upward price pressures. Philippine inflation went up for the first time in 6 months in August at 5.3%. The central bank kept its borrowing rate steady for a fourth straight meeting just last week. It has raised its lending costs by 425 basis points since last year to fight inflation. And a lawmaker calling on state auditors to examine the reported 2.6 million pesos confidential expenses in Davao City for the past 6 years when Vice President Sara Duterte was mayor. Let's get more details from our correspondent Michael Deliso. Michael, go ahead.
Hi, Nikki. Good afternoon. House Deputy Minority Leader and ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro has called on the Commission on Audit, or COA, to look into Davao City's spending of the reported 2.697 billion pesos confidential fund for the past 6 years when Vice President Sara Duterte was the mayor. Castro said the COA should thoroughly investigate if the funds were indeed used for confidential purposes and in line with the guidelines. If found otherwise, she said the money should be returned and appropriate charges should be filed. Castro said it is likely that Davao City spent 1.235 million pesos a day of secret spending for 6 years, way bigger than the country's richer cities such as Makati and Quezon cities. Earlier, Duterte's use of confidential funds came under scrutiny after it was revealed her office spent 125 million pesos in confidential funds over a span of only 11 days in 2022. In an online forum on Saturday, retired Supreme Court Associate Justice Antonio Carpio urged the Congress to enact a law to put reasonable limits on the full public disclosure of disbursement of public funds. For 2024, Duterte, who also heads the Department of Education, wants 500 million pesos in confidential funds, similar to what it received for the current fiscal year. She argued that basic education and national security are intertwined as there is a need to protect children from illegal drugs, criminality, violence, extremism, and terrorism. However, former COA Chief Heidi Mendoza pointed out that the agency has no mechanism, capacity, and structure to implement such plans, and that would rather be left to security agencies. Carpio said any public official's misuse of public funds or refusal to disclose expenses is ground in filing cases before the Office of the Ombudsman. Back to you, Nikki.
All right. Thanks for that report, Michael. Now, a recent survey says at least 50% of Filipino adults are dissatisfied with the K-12 curriculum. A teachers group believes there's a chance it's actually higher in reality. Teachers' Dignity Coalition Chairperson Benjo Basa says there are other findings about the curriculum's failure. He adds some employer groups are also not fond of hiring senior high school graduates, citing the lack of expected skills among them. Basas urges the Education Department to fix the basic needs in the sector, such as the curriculum, class scheduling, and even the competency of instructors.
Kung kailangan talaga pag-aralan, eh dapat yung magkaroon ng honest na review, saan siya nagkulang, saan ba tayo patungo kung pag-uusapan natin ang education na sector natin. In the end, desisyon na natin.
In other news, the Philippine Environment Department suspends its land agreement deal with the controversial Socorro Bayanihan Group in Surigao del Norte. The deal was awarded to the group in 2004, which covers 353 hectares of land. But the DENR says the group has violated some terms of that agreement, including its establishment of checkpoints within the leased area. A Senate probe over the alleged cult group's criminal activities, such as child marriage and rape, is now also underway. Meanwhile, the police have increased security in the town pending an investigation.
So far, wala naman po, ma'am, normal po, manageable po. Nandun po lahat yung mga PNP natin. Nag-deploy na po tayo ng karagdagang pwersa po. Hindi po yung sabihin na magulo po. Hindi po, ayusin lang po natin na maibawasan yung mga baka may gaganap po na kaguluhan. Yun lang po na dapat magkaroon kami ng sa active ba sa investigation at saka yung sa ano natin yung kailangan maayos yung pagkakandak ng security natin doon sa area. Kailangan na dagdagan, kung kailangan dagdagan ng pwersa at saka mag-maintain tayo ng 24 hours na checkpoint operation para po maintain natin yung kasiguruhan at saka yung kausayan sa lugar po na walang mangyari po.
Expelled Philippine lawmaker and alleged terrorist Arnolfo Teves Jr. met in Timor-Leste with former Senator Manny Pacquiao. A spokesperson of the Philippine Justice Department says this was confirmed with Pacquiao after photos and videos of the two surfaced online. Undersecretary Mico Clavano says the Justice Department was aware that Teves is in Timor-Leste. Clavano adds efforts to have Teves extradited to the Philippines are still underway.
Nakakuha din kami ng statement galing sa kampo ni former Senator Manny Pacquiao na ito ay isang chance encounter lamang po at hindi naman sinadya na magkita sila doon sa mismong airport. Patuloy pa rin yung plano ho namin, yung operation po namin. Hindi magbabago. We just know now for sure kung saan siya.
Photos of Pacquiao's meeting with various Timor-Leste officials were posted on Friday by the country's Ministry of Youth, Sports, Art and Culture. An oil price rollback is expected next week, the second one after an 11-week streak of fuel price increases. Estimates show a liter of gasoline could be cheaper by as much as 2 pesos and 30 centavos, while kerosene may see a decrease of up to 60 centavos per liter. But for diesel, prices may go up by at least 20 centavos. An update on the weather now. Jenny has strengthened into a tropical storm. Let's find out how this will affect weather conditions in the country from PAGASA weather forecaster Rhea Torres. Good afternoon, Rhea. What do you have for us?
Good afternoon. As of 10 a.m. this morning, the center of tropical storm Jenny was estimated at 1,025 kilometers east of central Luzon. It currently has maximum sustained winds of 65 kilometers per hour near the center and gustiness of up to 80 kilometers per hour, and is currently moving west-southwestward at a speed of 35 kilometers per hour. And although at the moment this tropical cyclone or tropical storm Jenny is still far from the Philippine landmass, therefore we currently have no tropical cyclone wind signal in effect over any parts of the country. And based from our outlook, The proximity, since the rain bands currently possessed by this tropical cyclone is still far or not affecting any parts of the Philippine landmass, it's not or directly affecting any parts of our country. However, due to its proximity and based from the latest forecast track, heavy rainfall over Batanes and Babuyan Islands may be experienced this Tuesday or Wednesday. Meanwhile, based on the latest forecast track, the southwest monsoon may be enhanced by this tropical cyclone over the next few days. So we're expecting occasional rains experienced over parts of western sections of southern Luzon and Visayas starting tomorrow. Meanwhile, parts of Calabar Zone and central Luzon may experience rainy weather starting by Tuesday. And that is the latest here from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. This is Rhea Torres reporting.
All right. Thanks as always, Rhea. You stay safe and dry.